pour out our praise to you, holy.
Great are you.
Great are you, Lord.
Come on, let's tell him that one more time. Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
Come on, let's exalt him in this place. Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
Oh, yes, Lord, you are great.
Yes, Lord.
You are great, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
I withhold nothing from you, Lord. You are worthy of all the praise, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Now pour out my praise,
yes, Lord,
to you only.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord, for
yes,
you are worthy. And as we hand back over to the moderator, we are going to declare together that we will exalt the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And I will exalt you.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
And I will exalt you. I will exalt you.
You are my God.
You are my God.
I will exalt you, Lord.
I will exalt you. I will. My treasure.
of the Lord.
He is here. He is here. Give him the glory.
Hallelujah.
Give him the honor. Give him the praise that is due unto his name.
Exalt his name.
We acknowledge you, Lord. We acknowledge you, Holy Spirit, that you are here with us this morning. Have your way. 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 Purge us, O God. Clean us, O God. Renew us, O God. Change us. Change us, O Lord. Change us, O God. Change us. Change us. Change us. Change us. Change us, O God. From the inside out, change us, O God. Change us. Change us. Change us, O God. Change us, O God. Change us, O Lord. Renew our minds, O Lord. Restore our souls, O God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, you are our God. You are our God. Hallelujah. We give you, Lord, all the honor. We give you, Lord, all the glory. We give you, Lord, all the praise that is due unto your name. Hallelujah to your name. Hallelujah to your name. Hallelujah to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Honor and glory and power and might unto you, O Lord. You alone are worthy of the praise. Give it all to you, O God. Hallelujah. 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 Awesome God. He is an awesome God.
Yes.
He is an awesome God.
Hallelujah.
We greet you, Holy Spirit. We welcome you.
Yes.
We welcome you above everyone else. We welcome you, Lord.
Father.
We welcome you, Lord. And we acknowledge that you are here. And we say thank you for being here. Thank you for being with us. With us, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, we give you thanks for the praise team and the musicians. We honor them. We give them thanks, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And I would just like to welcome everyone here this morning. And is anyone here for the first time? If you can raise your hands, we just want to acknowledge you. Thank you, sisters and brothers. Thank you, we acknowledge you, and we welcome you to Alpha and Omega, to the Women's Conference. We also welcome,
hallelujah,
and we greet those from the Beacon of Hope, Pastor Joan Morgan,
hallelujah,
Deacon White, and wife Veronica, we welcome you. Thank you very much for coming this morning. We welcome all the congregation, the pastors, the leaders, the ministers, and the children, we welcome you.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Just, and also the listeners, those who are listening online, we welcome you also. We just want to do some safety notes. To your left, we have the fire exits. If cases of fire, but we pray for the fire of the Holy Spirit. And if anyone needs any water or anything to drink, you can help yourself to things at the back. So welcome everyone to, once again, Door of Hope. We thank God that we have hope in him. And I don't want to take too much time. I want to get us straight into the word from visiting minister Linda Brown, who's a friend, who's family of Alpha and Omega. But before she comes, I would like to just read something that I believe that God has laid on my heart as I, you know, spoke to him about moderating today. I was a bit nervous, but if you're called, then you have to do what you're called to do. So I'm literally just going to read what came to me. So there are many things we have conceived in disgrace because of our adultery. And I say this because in Hosea, if you read the whole chapter of Hosea 2, it talks about Israel being the wife and giving herself to Baal and making sacrifices. And we do it in other ways. As even when the pastor said yesterday, where we can move from church to church, that could be a part of being adulterous. I'm not staying in one place, but as I'll read on. But because of God's amazing grace, he works on us, he forgives us, and he gives us that door of hope. Sometimes we can't change, but yet, because of our situation and circumstances, or the things that we ourselves have done, we can't actually change sometimes the results. However, God works it for our good. We either learn, grow, or sometimes good comes from it, or we benefit from the experience. We learn who we really are and not who we pretend to be, and what's really inside our hearts, and what we need to give to God for us to be all of his, more so that he has every area of our life, our hearts, our minds, to be all of his. Verses 14 to 15 in Hosea, where it says, therefore I am now going to allure her. I will lead her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. If you look at the word wilderness, it's not a nice place, but God yields us there. Wilderness, what does it mean? A place of nothingness. Loneliness, by yourself where there is no one else with you. People may be around you, but no one knows or feels your emotions and what really goes on inside of you. It's that place where we actually can really focus on God, because he is the only one we can see, or the only one we can have or can turn to in our wilderness. In this place, we hear him clearly. All distraction is gone. This is where he reveals who he is in our current situation, and also who we really are, what's in our hearts. The valley of Achor means trouble. So he makes a door out of that door of hope out of trouble. In this place, he can begin to heal the wounds, mend the broken hearts, where we cry and he catches those tears and places them in his bottle. He cares. It's a place where no one else really is with you, but where you and your husband, the Lord, walks with you together. He desires for us to no longer call him master. If we read on in that scripture, he says where a master, we do what we have to do because we have to do it. But he wants us to call him husband, where we desire to please him out of sincere love. Sometimes talking in our wilderness, but more so listening, as he says, I will speak to you tenderly. We have to be still, but also not just being still, but we keep moving at the same time. We don't stand still. It's a process. This is where we grow and become better people. When we put into practice what we have received in this place, the wilderness, when we are there, we have a peace despite what is going on around us. And when we come out, we are different women and men, where we have changed. Over the years, we go through different situations and circumstances that stretch us and pull us into places of loneliness with God. It distracts us, but causes us to change. Change occurs in our thoughts, in our heart, and should come out in actions. Old habits take time to develop, and new ones will the same. Sometimes we have to be patient with ourselves as we allow those changes to manifest in and through our lives. But ultimately, it is our decision and our choices to let this new heart shine through. We are in control, and we have to stop pretending that we have no control of what we do and say and think. Make that choice to walk in that newness as God has allowed us to go through and come out. Many of these places, bad habits, we have got ourselves into as the Lady Israel in the scripture, by our own poor choices, even by the negative effects that life has thrown our way. Where we harden our hearts, we face our consequences. However, God, in his mercy, has shown and revealed us his way, the truth, and we have to take up our cross and follow his way in our words, in our deeds, and in our action, not just on a Sunday, hallelujah, but every day of the week and in our own heads. It's our choice. Amen. Next we have, before Sister Linda comes on, a poetic drama by Sister Marilyn. So please, can you give her a round of applause? It is titled Stripped.
This drama is a poetic drama and it's called Stripped. Just let the Holy Spirit have his way. I only knew I was going to do this myself just a couple of days ago. So, and then the song that's going to be added to the end, God just downloaded it to me Thursday night. So let everything be done according to his will, in Jesus' name. The woman you see in front of you was once a child. This fictional story is common, but I'd like you to listen to it for a while. At the age of 13, she was inflicted with pain, abused by her father, who did it again and again. Even though she cried, he would carry it on, for she was a child and he was a strong man. Abuse sexually, mentally, and physically went deep. She kept it all in. At night, she would not sleep. She would cry for help, but no one came. Was it her to blame? As she grew, she started to hate. She hated herself most of all. She saw people as fakes. She saw nothing that made her special. At the age of 14, she would meet guys. Many of them she knew. When they asked her for a date, she would not refuse. By the age of 15, she had slept with many men, so she decided to hide. She ran away from home and got mixed up with people she did not know. She was introduced to crack, speed, and used it to numb the pain. She thought it was great, as she did not have to think. So she lived on it and also turned to drink. Now being 16 and relying on friends, she met Nathaniel. He was a pimp. He treated her special, so she fell in love. But he told her he would only be around if she gave herself to other men. She thought this was easy, no big deal. After all, she was not real. She did this for a year, but started to hate it. Grimy old men laid with her, some of them reminding her of her dad. She started again to feel very, very sad. The drugs and drinks increased, so most of the time she was stoned. One day she found out she was pregnant. It was for Nathaniel, as she would use protection. He told her to abort the child, otherwise how would she survive? She would be no use to him and couldn't be his wife. Babies don't go well with this job, so my sweet get rid. She stood dumbstruck for a while. because she loved him, she did. After the abortion, she did not feel the same. It felt like something had been taken from her. She was in more pain. Her heart ached and there was a longing too. I could have had my baby to love me for true. She would cry at night and ease the pain by drinking, taking drugs, and going on the game. She was confused. She was lost. She wanted to run away from her past. Where could she go? What was this life? She stopped caring for herself. Nathaniel started to beat her and ask where's her pride. One night she decided she would not go on. She looked for a way out, but there was none. She stared at the speed, the crack cocaine, and thought, well, if I took a larger dose, that would end my pain. She was about to do exactly that, but all of a sudden, she was stopped. I love you. I love you. I love you, my child. There's hope in me, Jesus. I've been knocking for a while. Startled, she looked up and saw a loving smile. Nail pierced and stretched out to her. She dropped the stuff and cried and cried, as she felt a warm sensation on her inside. The words she heard rang in her ears. I love you, I love you. She held up her hands and said, help me, Jesus, please, as she slowly bowed to her knees. As this love she had never felt before surrounded her, she knew for sure that her life would now change. So with every strength she had on the inside, worship flowed from her.
Thank you.
Knows our name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Sister Marilyn. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows our name. He knows our name. He knows my name. He knows my name. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Does he know your name? Do you hear him speaking to you today? Say, he knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. Oh, how he walks with me. Oh, how he walks with me. How he talks to me. Oh, how he talks to me. How he loves me. Oh, how he loves me. He knows my name. 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 As you sing it, he knows my name, he knows.
He knows my name.
He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. Yes, he does. Yes, he does. He knows my name. Still and know that he is God. In your situation, he is God, and he is with you. No matter how hard, he is with you, and he loves you, and he cares for you. And yes, he knows your name. He will reach down into the deepest pit just for you. He knows your name. He loves you. He cares for you. He died on the cross just for you, one, you. He knows your name. Don't ever forget that he knows your name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you. I just want to introduce someone to you. Linda K. Brown is a phenomenal woman who loves God and his plan for her life. She's a native of Memphis, Tennessee, currently living in, I can't pronounce that, Gatlinburg, Maryland, Gaithersburg, Maryland. She has ministered around the world and as an ordained minister, professionally certified life coach and counselor. She seeks to help people know God's purpose and plan for their lives and live it every day. Linda is passionate about people, understanding their plan is pregnant with purpose, their purpose, and that everything that has happened in life can be used as a stepping stone or a stumbling block. It's all in perspective. Linda is a retired school counselor and is in full-time ministry. Furthermore, she graduated from Leadership Training Center of Impact Church, now Impact College, Jacksonville, Florida, and was the most outstanding student, highest GPA. Woo woo!
Amen.
She holds a Bachelor of Science in Interdisciplinary Studies in a concentration in music and psychology.
Yeah.
Amen. From Norfolk State University in Virginia, and a Master's of Arts in Community Counseling from Regent University, Virginia Beach. Additionally, Linda has a number of certifications in a variety of marriage and family relationship programs, as well as she is a behavior specialist and mediator. She is the president and co-founder of Giving Hope, Giving People Hope International Ministries, Inc. And she is launching a new business and a new ministry, Purposeful Coaching and Coaching, LLC, and Linda Burst Brown Ministries International. She is a member of the Impact Church, Jacksonville, Florida. She is now single and a mother, grandmother, and a great-grandmother, great-great-grandmother. Linda lives to encourage, educate, and empower people to know who they are and why they are, because she believes everyone is perfect for their purpose. Please welcome Minister Linda Brown.
Hearts adore.
Saved, you don't have a relationship with Jesus. Anybody? Well, amen, it's on. Ah. Come on, raise your hands to God. Father, we bless you today. You are a matchless King. There is none like you. We thank you right now for the privilege we have to worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, right now we ask you to anoint as only you can, Holy Spirit. This worship experience, continue to anoint it afresh. We right now yield our wills to you for you to have your way in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the head of this house, Bishop Errol and Pastor Noreen Campbell. We ask you to bless them abundantly. Bless Alpha and Omega. Bless everyone under the sound of my voice right now. And again, your perfect will be done in the hearts and minds of your people to your praise and to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may have your seat. Well, I don't know if you know... This is supposed to be a workshop. Everybody said workshop. So that means you're going to work. I won't just stand here and, you know, preach and teach. No, we're working today. So you're going to participate. But before you do, what's the title of this experience for the women? Well, everybody now. It's not just women. What's the title? Say it again. Everybody else, tell you caught on now. What is it? Well, we came in through several doors today, right? Well, first of all, Naomi, you did a great job. You did wonderful. She read some extraordinary stuff as she was ministering there. That was all in my message. I'm like, wow. Like, really? But it was so good. And it is so important. I mean, I'm not here for form or fashion. I'm not here because I'm cute. I really am cute. I am. But I'm not here because of that. I'm not here because of what I have on or what I have. None of that. None of that. I'm here because I truly love God, and most of all, God loves me. And I know that he loves me. Now, I don't know how many of you really believe that. I don't know how many of you really have a relationship, but we're going to talk about relationship today. We're going to talk about relationship with God, since all of y'all said y'all saved. I'm going to give you one more chance. Anybody else is not saved now? All right. Then it applies to you. If you're saved today, you have a relationship with God. We're going to talk about your relationship with God. We're also going to talk about relationship with yourself. How many know yourself? If I were to point to you today, you could stand up and you can give me a whole sentence about who you are. Okay, how many of you could not tell me who you are in one sentence? I'm going to try you. I promise. I'm going to tap on you, and you're going to be able to stand. Because all of y'all, I saw one hand go up that said she could, and I know she would. But I'm not going to let her do it. Since none of you raised your hands and said you couldn't, let's see who will be first. Dun 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 dun. Hey, my brother, how you doing? You're not in because it's a woman's conference, so I won't do that to you. I'm gonna do it to this lady right here. I was gonna go there, but I'm going. Who are you in one sentence?
I'm a child of God.
What's your name?
My name is Pauline. Small.
Okay. So her name is?
Pauline.
And and it means what?
Small.
All right. Now, if Pauline knows who she is, what her name means, and what her relationship with God is, because she said she was a child of
God.
Yes. If she really knows that, then no matter what comes up in her life, I don't care what it is, Shantae, that comes up in her life, she's going to walk tall, even though she's small. Because she has a right relationship with God. And I don't know how many of you live your life from victory, but that's what we are designed as born-again believers. We're supposed to be living our lives from victory, not victim. Every day, no matter what happens, no matter how bad it is, no matter how many jobs you lose, no matter how much money you don't have, no matter how barren you may be, it does not matter. You live your life from victory. Why? Because Jesus Christ gave you victory. How did he do that? He died on the cross. He bled. He died, but he got up. That's the good part. He suffered, but he got up. So that you could live from a place of victory, not victim. So we're going to talk about that today. How no matter what comes up in your life, now I've been through some stuff. But now I know that it was just stuff. It had no power, nothing more than I give it. Only way things can take you over is you allow it to. You give in to it. I was going to have something else to happen, but I think I'm going to bypass that for right now. We're talking about relationship. God is for us. That's one of your scriptures, Romans 8:31. It says, if God is for us, then what? Say it again. If God, it said personally, if God is for me, who can be against me? Now, how many of y'all really believe that? Okay, it's a test. We're going to see. If God is for you, who in the world can be against you? So let's go to the beginning. Somebody get Genesis, the first chapter, verses 26 and 27, I believe is where we're going. Genesis, the first chapter. Told you this participation today. Genesis, the first chapter, verse 26 and 27. And you've heard it before. And I'm not going to need y'all, so y'all can join us. Wonderful band. Give a hand clap to the band. They were good. Genesis, the first chapter, beginning at the beginning, and we're starting at verse 26. If you have it, say amen. If you need more time, say, wait a minute. Wait a minute. I'm talking to myself. Okay. All right, you have it? I'm in the New King James Version. It says, then God said, let us make man in our image, say our image, according to our likeness, say our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. Say dominion.
Dominion.
All right. So, verse 27 says, God created man in his image. Say, I was created
in God's image.
In the image of God, he created me. Male and female, he created them. All right. So, you were made in God's image. You were made in his likeness. That means you look like him and you act like him. That was the plan at the beginning. Something happened in the beginning after the plan. Man got his own idea from, you know, an influence, the enemy. And stuff happened that was not in God's plan. So, God said, oh, okay, let me rearrange things. And then all of this stuff happened, laws and all that kind of stuff came about. Never could fulfill those laws. It was impossible for them to really fulfill them. He just let it happen, okay? But then Jesus came along and said, wait a minute, I can do something about what has happened. I can redeem back. I can give back the plan that God had originally. That was for us to look like him, act like him, and to rule and reign like him on the earth. That's the only reason we're here. That's the only reason you're here. You're here to do God's will according to his plan for your life. That's why you exist. Some of y'all been wondering, why in the world am I here? Why in the world? Well, that's a general statement. We're going to get more specific as we go along. So now that you know that you're made in God's image, say, I look like God. Come on. Say, I look like God. I'm supposed to act like God. And if you're a child of the king, you will. And you're supposed to rule. So I'm supposed to rule. Oh, some of y'all don't believe that because you're not saying it. It's that I, like the queen, am supposed to rule. Now, y'all know y'all got this thing going on. We don't have this in the States, and I'm not going to talk about the States and where we are right now. Praise Jesus. But you all have a queen. Y'all used to have kings. And so y'all know about rulership. You know about coming under authority, right? How many of you don't know how to come under authority? All right. So you are supposed to do the ruling. Life runs through relationships, and I do apologize. The projector is not working, so I was smart and I printed out my PowerPoint. Ain't that God good? Yes. So we're going to do a little thing now called the Johari window. There were two guys that created this, Joseph Luft and Harry Ingram. And so it's a combination of their names. Now we're going to actually get a chance to do something. So put all of your stuff down. We're going to get paper. Can I get Chantel and, yes, to come and help me with passing out this. Everyone gets one because I have enough for everybody. And we're going to do a little exercise. It's called the Johari window. And I'm going to ask you a question. What? Well, not yet. It's a tool designed to help people better understand their relationship with themselves and with others. How many of you know that it was never God's plan for you to be by yourself on earth? How many of y'all try to be by yourself? You just love being by yourself. You don't want people's. I'm a project person, so I like y'all when the project is going on, you know. But once the project is over, you all go home and leave me alone because that's the way I am. That's my design. But we were created to have a relationship, first with God, then with ourselves, then with others, okay? And once we really know that and embrace that, that's a good thing. How many need a pen or a pencil? Oh, great, y'all can't prepare to work because it's a workshop. All right. Don't forget the band up here. The band needs some paper, too. You have four different boxes on there, so we're going to start. Let me see, are the numbers? The numbers are up there. Wow, good. So once everyone gets one, we're going to get started. All right, number one, the first window, and you write these words, and it says, I know, just write it down, I know, K-N-O-W. And right under that, you put, you know. I know and you know. So that's the first box. What that's basically saying is, how many of you have never met me before? You've never seen me before today. Fabulous. Then only these persons that have never seen me before get to respond to this question. What is it that you know about me and you just saw me for the first time today?
Yes. That your name is Linda Brown.
Okay. See, she know my name, Linda Brown. And she just met me. What is it that you know about me?
Your name is Linda Brown.
Anything else?
You're a single mom.
I'm single. A lot of y'all didn't know that. I ain't gonna be single long though. I'm about to get married again. Okay. Anything else? And you've just met me. Something else that you know about me that you didn't know?
That you sing beautifully.
I sing beautifully. Thank you very much. Anybody else that just met me for the first time today? Never seen me before. Yes, ma'am. What do you know about me?
You're a counselor in relationships and you're a teacher.
Listen at that. And she just met me. Isn't this something? She just met me. She knows that. Uh-oh. Yes, ma'am.
You're a citizen from the United States.
I sure am. I'm a citizen of the United States of America. Now, how about that? Just met me, and they know that. So there are things about you that people that have never seen you before know about you when they see you. How is that? Well, they can look at you. You all heard those things about me in this service today, or you experienced it. You experienced my singing. You heard them talk about me, and I hate that kind of stuff, too, all that stuff. But, yeah. So there are things about you that people that have never seen you before know. For example, you know my hair color is salt and pepper, right? Salt, pepper. You know I got on black and white? Because you can see that. When you encounter people on an everyday basis, you know things about them, and they know things about themselves. The same thing, because you can see it. The next one, number two, there are things that I know, but I know, and you don't know. So put in there, I know, but also put in there, you don't know. Because there are some things about me that I know that you don't know. You can't see. It wasn't in my brief bio. For example, you don't know that my dad was born in 1895. Not my grandfather, my father was born in, he was a stud. Yeah, he was 59 when I was born. Mm-hmm, girl. And my mama was 33. But they were so perfect for each other because they made me. Ha ha! So there are things about you that if you don't let people know, they won't ever know. For example, putting you on the spot, tell me something that nobody knows, only you.
About myself. I'm very secretive.
She's very secretive. How many of you knew that about Marilyn? You knew that about Marilyn? She said she knew that, Marilyn, about you. Let's see who else will know something about themselves that nobody else knows. Sister B.
Yes, my darling. Ma'am. Right. That I know about myself.
Yeah, that nobody in here knows about you.
Yes, there are things that they don't know about me. Yes.
Sister B, I want to tell y'all what's up. Oh, yes, I'm picking on you. Something that you know that none of us know.
When I came to England.
When you came to England? Okay, yeah. When did you come to England?
In 1981.
How many of you knew that she came to England in 1981? Okay. How many of y'all done figured out my age by now? How many of you know what year I was born in? You don't know. Y'all didn't do the math. I was born in 1954. So if I don't tell you the things about myself that you don't know, you won't know unless you try to figure it out, right? There are things about yourself that only you can share with somebody, and that calls for a level of trust. Now, if you don't know, God knows all things about you. Everything about you. But he is a spirit. And we are in the flesh. So he wants you to commune in fellowship with some fleshly peoples. To tell them some things about yourself that they don't know. So you can be a relationship. But it comes with trust. Because you can't tell everybody some of the things that you've done. Because they're going to look at you cross-eyed. They're going to look you up and down. They're going to say, she ain't saved. She can't be saved because she says words out of her mouth that are not godly. That's another thing about me. I used to be a cussing saint. Just cuss. Just say it. Then it's like, okay, Lord, forgive me, Lord Jesus, forgive me that, in Jesus' name. Then I got made, somebody affected me in the way that I was upset, and I did it again. Okay, none of y'all have ever, made a mistake and let the wrong word come out of y'all mouth. But I'm going to tell you, I was a cussing saint. I had to repent and ask the Lord to help me. He has helped me that I don't cuss. No, I ain't gonna say them no more. I ain't gonna lie until that. But I haven't used an explicit word in a long time. How about that? Amen. Amen and amen. See, I'm being honest with you. And then when you can be honest with a person, they can say, oh, she let her guard down. She trusts me. Maybe I can talk to her about some things that are going on in my life. Because, saints are hurting. Some of you have walked in here with some burdens on you today. You are burdened down, but you got a smile on your face. You don't want nobody to know how you're hurting. But Jesus knows, and some of us know too. The third block is that you know, I don't know. You know, I don't know. Now, how in the world could you know something about me that I don't know about myself? Is that possible? Put these words in that blind spot. Blind spot. Everybody has a blind spot. How many of you drive cars or a vehicle at all? How many of you know that there's a blind spot? Sometimes you can't see, even though you got two mirrors. But sometimes you cannot see the car that is right there behind you because there's a blind spot. There are blind spots in your life that you don't see. And if you have not built a relationship with someone, if you have not allowed your guard to be down and you shared and opened yourself up to them, when they see something that's going on with you that you cannot see, they may not want to tell you. Because they say, oh, if I tell her that, if I tell him that, she gonna look at me and she might want to lose some explicits on me. Like, what in the world are you talking about? You don't see that. But they do. For example, if I had a piece of paper on my back right now, would I know that? Why? I can't see in the back unless I do it in the mirror, and then still I can't see. But if you see me walking around, and this is the truth, or this is not, you know, I'm not joking or anything. If you see something on the back of me and my hair out of place, tell me. So I can put it in place, because I like to be put in place. I like to, yes, I do. That's something else you didn't know about me. You understand what I'm saying? So then you have to come to a place in your heart and your mind. You have to become so open and so vulnerable that when someone sees something in your life, they may see that you are stumbling. They may see that you are hurting. And they want to let you know, I see your pain. Please allow me to walk with you. She said in her dissertation earlier that we're to be bearers of one another's burden, but sometimes we don't know how to help a sister out. We don't. Some of us don't want to hear the truth, first of all. But God designed relationship. He was the one that said, I don't see myself on the earth. I've created everything. All these animals out here, and still I don't see myself. So let me see myself. So he created Adam. And when he created Adam, that was himself, all complete, total God. How now? Because the female was not there. Yes, she was. She was on the inside. So then God allowed Adam to be like himself. He said, okay, you have my authority now to be me. And Adam looked around. He named all of the animals. Wasn't it something that he could name an elephant and he had never seen it before? He could call out a lion. Never seen a lion before. He had never seen any of the stuff that God created. Yet he had the authority. Yet he had the wisdom to call it what it was. Because he was created in God's image. After he got through naming all that stuff, he didn't see himself, though. So if you ever relate to an animal in the wrong way, not God. He did not see himself. So God said, wait, he don't see himself like I see myself, so let me put him to sleep. Let me take woman out. Put her beside him. He woke up and he went, oh, there I am. He did. He then saw himself. It was a compliment to himself. So the two, woman and man, creates the perfect image to God of who God is. And it's when we work in harmony and symphony with one another, complementing each other's lives, first of all in our own life, that we know who we are. We are a whole, complete being. Whole and complete. And then when the Lord blesses us, should we desire to become a mate to someone, they are whole and you are whole. That means two wholes come together, not a half and a half. Doesn't work. You got to be a whole individual. You got to know who you are. That's God's design. So there are things in your life that you don't know, that God is putting people in your life today as I speak to be your blind spot person, to show you some of the things in your life that you cannot see. That's going to help your life be better. But it's only going to come after you share some things about yourself that they have no idea. I know I can be curt or sharp at people, and it's not my intention. I'm just a matter-of-fact person. So I temper my words. I temper how I speak to people most of the time because I know they don't know that I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm just saying what's on my mind. I'm saying right. And sometimes you used to come out of the room with girl Naomi, and you know one of my daughters and my son. My children used to tell me, Mama, it is not what you said. It is how you say it. You just, they didn't say it, but it's like you rip us up one side and down the other. So I learned that about myself. They knew that. I didn't know that. All I knew was I'm telling you the truth. This is the way it is, and this is what's supposed to be done, when it's supposed to be done, how it's supposed to be. Okay. And it was hurting people's feelings. That wasn't my intention. The last block, number four, only God knows. There are things in your life I don't know, you don't know, only God knows. And when we tap into that relationship with him and we're willing to hear from God the truth, he'll show us. He showed me Linda. Oh, my God. Did he show me Linda? Ooh. Jesus. He's still showing me her, too. Yes, he is, Noreen. Noreen's been knowing me for a long time. Noreen knows the good about me. Good. Noreen knows the bad about me. Noreen knows even the ugly about me. When I was going through some stuff, I called all the way to England because she's my friend, y'all. She's like a sister to me. Her bishop is like a brother. And they literally know a lot that has transpired in my life. The only reason, though, that I believe I could talk to Noreen and tell her some things, first of all, when I told her the ugly stuff about me, guess what? Noreen, you still love me, right? Say it out loud so they can hear you. Love you, Linda. See that? And she know how ugly I have been. Because I told her the truth. Nothing but the truth, so help me God. She genuinely still loves me, though. That's the truth. That's the type of people that God wants to place in your life. You need people. Some of us don't think we do, but you do. And you need them for purposes. How many of y'all got something out of this little exercise? It's going to take you somewhere. Now, let's go with a big question. This is a huge question. And everybody gets to participate that wants to. What is the greatest nation? The greatest nation, hands. The greatest nation, hands, so I can call on you. What do you think the greatest nation is? Let me go back here. Yes, ma'am.
I say Africa.
Africa?
She says Africa, okay? Yes, ma'am. You got a different answer?
Israel.
Israel, okay. Anybody else?
I'm thinking maybe the Middle East, no?
The Middle East? Okay, anybody else? Huh? One more. This is it.
Great Britain.
Great Britain. All right. Well, it's got great in there. Yes, ma'am.
USA. And I'll say Europe.
Europe. All right. Yes, ma'am.
I said the nation of God.
She said the nation of God. Okay, I want just the last response I'm going to get. Hold on.
God's kingdom.
Okay. She's with the heathen. God's kingdom. I'm going to burst y'all bubbles. The greatest nation. Write it down. Is imagination. Imagination. That's the greatest nation. Why is it the greatest nation? Because you can imagine anything. Anything. You can. I imagined myself going to Paris when I was in the eighth grade years ago. And so I decided that I'm going to Paris. I don't care hook or crook. I'm going, Pauline. So I took 3 years of French in high school so I could be prepared. Oui, oui. Je m'appelle Linda et tout. Okay. Parlez-vous français? Oui, oui.
Comment ça va?
I'm all right. I don't know too much more because I lost it all. And I was going to go to college once I got out of high school, and I was going to major in French in high in college too, so I could get an internship in Paris. That didn't work because in the 11th grade, of high school, I became pregnant, and they put me out of school. So my plan was going downhill. Like, okay, wait a minute, God, don't look like I'm going to get to college because I got a child now. Then I get married in my 12th year, the senior year of my, I get married, so I'm a mom and a wife. Okay, don't look like I'm going to college. Then I had another baby like 2-3 years later. Then I had another baby, then I had another baby. So it wasn't no school for me with babies and, you know, being a wife. And until I met Noreen and Errol Campbell, and I started coming to London, and they said, and they said, on one of them trips we came over here, we're gonna take you all for a day trip to what? See, I'm not making this up. I'm really genuinely happy. Y'all don't know how happy I was. Because, see, my dream was deferred, but it was not over. I had dreamed to go to Paris. I had my plan that did not work. You better hear what I'm saying to you today. I had my plan, but it didn't work like that. But I still had the dream. And God fulfilled the dream His way. God has a plan for your life. You may have your own desires and your own thing that's going on to think, okay, this is the way I'm going to get it. But God may have a different perspective as to how you're going to get it. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. But that was a good testimony, wasn't it? Yeah, let me add to it. I went to Paris the next year, and I wasn't just there for just a day. We was there for 3 days and 2 nights. Then the next time I went, because I went 3 times, y'all. I've been to Paris 3 times. 3! See how God will do that? Had no idea that I was going to be in Norfolk, Virginia, in a church that 2 people were going to come to. I was going to meet them. I was going to even come to their church and do ministry. And then they were going to take me on one of my dreams be fulfilled. But that was God's way of saying, I have not forgot you, Linda. God has not forgotten you. Some of you have your dreams, you've buried them. You're not dreaming anymore. But let me tell you, I wrote a song that says, all things are possible to him who believes all things are possible to him who believes it and receives it and will say it in Jesus' name. That's a song, and it's a word. All things are possible to him who believes all things are possible to him who believes it and receives it and will say it in Jesus' name. If you believe it and it's in the will of God, it can happen. I'm excited. I'm not going to get ahead of myself. So the greatest nation is imagination. God has given everything that pertains to life and godliness. That's in 2 Peter, the first chapter, verse 3. All we have to do is to tap into it and live our design purpose. But how do we do that? First of all, I said that the greatest nation is. So I want you to imagine right now. I want you to write down on the back of that paper that I gave you and write down, you can write down one word, one phrase, one sentence. One thing that if you knew is impossible for you to fail. No, your success is guaranteed in this. Dream right now. Write it down. Just one thing that you're dreaming about. One thing. And if you're dreaming about it and you can do it, then it's not a big enough dream. You need to dream like, you know, you don't know, only God can make it happen, Chantel, only God. Mm-hmm. I love to travel, and God has arranged for me to be a world traveler, and he did it. That was one of my dreams. I used to see my aunt and uncle come home from California to Memphis, where I'm from, and they would visit us, and I said, one day I'm going to do that. One day I'm going to be coming back to Memphis, and exactly that's what I do now. Go home every now and then. Write it down. One dream. One thing that you, if it was, there's no ifs, ands, and buts. It will happen. And I want you to remember that as we go on in this session. I got to keep my time. All right, we're going to go through an acronym now, and it's called How Are You Shaped, S-H-A-P-E-D. And the SHAPED is for, it's an acronym that we're going to be using right now to talk about where you are. We're going to start with the D, though. Everybody write down dreams, desires, and I'm going to talk about that for a minute. So the dream or the desire that you just wrote down is where you start with understanding how you are shaped. If you got a dream, like I told you, I dreamed of doing what I'm doing right now. I used to see myself pretending I was a musician in church. I was 4 years old. My mother bought me a little play piano. And I used to bang on it, literally bang on it, and I would sing. Now, I could sing real good, but that banging was awful. Sound terrible. But I pretended like I was a musician of the church. And I actually wanted to be the musician of the church. So me and my brother would practice. He was a preacher and I was a musician and a singer. And we'd go through a whole service, you know, in our backyard. And I would be playing on my little piano or the steps, the concrete steps that you walk up. That was my piano too, you know, because I was banging anyway, you know. But guess what? I became the musician of a church. Yes, I did. And that was God, too. My mother wanted me to take piano lessons and stuff, but I heard these horrible stories about the instructors, that if you hit the wrong note, they'll hit your hand with a little wooden spoon or wooden ruler. I'm like, mm-mm, that ain't happening, because they hit me, I might hit them, then my mama gonna hit me, my mama gonna kill me. So I didn't go that route. I did learn to play, you know, watching my friends and stuff like that and kind of listening to stuff. So, and then I went to college for music, but I didn't like that. That was my plan, and I didn't like it at all. Them people were boring. So I dropped out of that, and I started taking psych classes, and I became a counselor. But I still play for churches, and I still sing. And I don't like playing as much as I do singing. I love to sing. It was a dream, though. It was just a dream. But it became a reality, and God made it a reality. How did I become a musician of a church? I went to a tea that I was invited to, and my cousin was throwing a tea at her church. She wanted me to do the devotion, sing a song, read a scripture, and pray. I said, no problem, I can do that. So I went, and I was in high school. I was a senior in high school. And the musician was late. They started the tea, and the musician wasn't there, Naomi. So I've got to sing my song without music. I'm like, no, I'm not. I know this song. I didn't know but two. But I know that song. So I sit down and I played I Need Thee Every Hour. I sang. I read my scripture. And I prayed. And I sat down. I was so excited. My cousin said, girl, I didn't know you could play the piano. I said, I can't. I know two songs. We need a musician for our church. And I'm going to ask Aunt Reba, which my mom. I said, no, you're not. Because I don't play for no church. I know two songs. I Need Thee Every Hour, and We Shall Overcome Someday. This is a true story. That girl went home, called my mother. Hey, Reba, I didn't know she could play. We need a musician for our church. Can she play for our church? Mama said, sure. I said, they both crazy, Lord. What's wrong with them? That's how I became a musician for a church. You said, how did you play for a church only knowing two sounds? Good question. I went scared as all get out. Scared. Now, what motivated me was that they were going to pay me. So I thought, I can do all things through the money that's going to strengthen me. Because I was in high school and, you know, I needed 2 cents. And then I had a child too, so it would come in handy, the little money they were going to pay me. So I went, I said, I don't know. I said, help me, Lord. I was really scared, to be honest. But the director of the choir was an accomplished singer. She could read music, and she actually taught me how to play. She cannot play, but she taught me how. And her sister-in-law, who could play. So that began my what I was dreaming about when I was 4 years old. See how God's plan came about? Now, I wouldn't have done that at all. I'm going somewhere. Some of you have your plans. I don't know who you are. I do prophesy too, okay? I'm not the prophet that you're going to follow, though, to get that word she was talking about the other night. But some of you have your own plans for your life. You're one of them. You have for a long time planned and planned and planned things. You have seen things in your life. You are a wonderful, meek, and humble-spirited woman. You really are. And you have things inside of you that God wants to come out. You want them to come out, but you've been trying in your own strength. Today, God is going to give you a specific word for you to follow for your life. And some things that have been deep down inside of you are going to come to pass. Today, you're going to start walking out His plans for your life. God has not forgotten you. He has not forgotten you. He has not. There are some others of you that have your own thing going on. Some of you are real discouraged. Don't be. Today is your day to hear the word of the Lord and start walking in it. Let's go to the S. The S means spiritual gift. Everybody has a spiritual gift. The Romans, the 12th chapter, it starts around verse 6, and it talks about those gifts. If you have prophecy, teacher, if you're an exhorter, if you're a giver, if you're an administrator, if you're a server, if you're a teacher, there are 9 gifts there. One of them is in your life. Now, we operate in almost all of them at some point in our lives. But there's one strong gift that's in your life that you operate out. Mine is exhorter and prophet. And sometimes they reverse themselves. It's prophetic. And prophetic means to have an insight into somebody's life. But I do it from the Spirit of the Lord, not myself, because I don't know nothing about, you know, I know some of you, but only God can reveal some things about you. So every one of you has a spiritual gift. The H is for heart or passion. Heart or passion. And what that means is that some of y'all eat, sleep, drink. I mean, you go to bed with it. You get up out of the bed with it. You don't so long to do this thing. You just can't let it go. My daughter was 3 years old, and she was telling me, my baby girl, that she wanted to do commercials and she wanted to act and stuff. Well, we were living in Florida, and she wanted to go to California. It was a long way. And it wasn't in our plan at all. I heard my daughter. I took her to acting lessons in Florida and stuff, and my daughter turned 40 on the 15th of October. My daughter is living that dream now. She lives in Los Angeles, California, and she is pursuing her entertainment purse of who she is. Now, God took her out there, though, on a job she was working on. The job moved her to California. Not L.A., but another part. The job didn't work out in that other part of California, so she packed up all of her stuff in faith and moved to L.A. When she got to L.A., she already knew some people that had their own production companies and stuff, and she knows people in the entertainment business, but she knew that wasn't the way that she was supposed to go. She wasn't supposed to go through them some people. If I call their names, y'all would know them, so I'm not going to do that. She didn't go that route. She allowed God to open the doors for her. So that was a dream. And God saw the dream, and now she's living the dream. I'm telling you, there's some things that you've been passionate about. You eat, you sleep, you drink. I eat, I sleep, I drink, encouraging people. It's what I do. I don't have to get paid for it. I do that. That's just who I am. You have a passion, some of you. The A is for abilities. We have been equipped by God with abilities, talents, skills. One of my talents is to sing. I have the gift of gab, too. I can talk. Woo! I like it, too. I like to talk. You know, being a counselor, you shouldn't want to talk, but you also should want to listen. I'm a great listener as well. I have the ability to play the piano, as you heard. I can do a few other things. My mother was gifted. My mother could build. You see these doors here? She could take it from scratch, take the wood and do all that needs to be the wood, temper it, cut it to that size, cut the window out. She could shellac it and make it that cut. My mother could do that. Never went to school for that. She could look at a garment and sew it. Didn't need a pattern. My mother was talented. She was one of the first persons that I knew when she died at 82, she had lived her purpose. She did what she was supposed to do on the earth. Those were talents that God gave her to be able to sow, to be able to build things. She built a picket fence around our house. She could upholster. She could take a sofa apart and put it back together. My mama was, she was something else. Ooh, we're that lady there. There's some gifts, there's some talents, there's some abilities in you that have been living dormant. Some of y'all have buried your talent. Some of y'all, your talents has gotten you kind of in trouble. And I don't know who that's for. Somebody in here, your talent, your ability has gotten you in trouble. But we've talked about people. Last night she talked about Rahab, prostitute. A lot has been said about the Valley of Achor, and I'm going to go there in a little bit. Some of y'all stuff, though, has gotten you in trouble. But God can take the trouble. God can take the mess and make a message out of it. The P is for personality. We all have a personality. Personality means what makes you tick and what ticks you off. That's what personality is. We all have one. Some of us are direct people. We tell people what to do, when to do it, how to do it. We like to drill sergeant. Go left, go right, go up, go down. Pick this paper up over here. I need you to organize this. I need you to do that. I need you to do that. I need you to do this. Some of y'all smiling like, that's me. Huh? Some people are that way. That's their personality. Some people are so demure, though. They're just shy, and they're in the corner. But they'll serve you if you need a cup of coffee or if you need a mint or whatever you need. They'll just give it to you. They're so, yes, there's some people like that. Ain't me. But there are some people like that. So shy. Then there are some people that want everything together. They want it right. They want it all in order, correct. They want to look good, everything, all the hair in place. Eyebrows arched perfectly. Lipstick on where you can see it real well. The clothes are not as tight as they are that are on me now, but they're on me. There's some people like that. That would be me. Then there are some people that's the life of the party. They're the life of the party, Nick. When they get there, girl, all they want you is have fun. Hey, let's do that thing. Hey, hey, hey. And they want everybody to have fun. So those are the four, and they're different names for them, those different people. I do the DISC. The D is for the direct people. The I is for the inspirational people or the life of the party people. The S is for the people that are really steady and shy and reserved. Then the C is for the people that are correct, in order. Again, we all have a personality. That's a God thing. The spiritual gift that you have is a God thing. The personality that you have is a God thing. And usually God links us up with people that have the opposite personality to us. Because I always seem to get those life of the party people. They just want to, and I'm like, sit down somewhere. I always seem to gravitate to those people, Beverly, for some reason. I just want them to sit down, you know. And then we have like the D's and the C's. They're the people that like the project. Whatever the project is going on, they're in for it. Them I people and them S people, oh, they like the people. They want people around all the time, day and night. People, people, people. People, people, people. People. Then there are the D and the I people. They're the out part. They're the extroverts. They're out there, and they don't mind being in front of people. How many of y'all think I like being out here in front of people? Yeah. No. I'm in with them C's and them S's. We like introverts. I'm an introvert. So you see, you have all those characteristics, and then some mixture of them. Now, we have characteristics of all of them, but one dominates your life. One of those things dominates your life. And it's okay. And it's okay that you are different, not bad, not wrong. You're just different than somebody else. Even with your gift, you're different than someone else. But the scripture says that we have gifts that are different, but they do what? They work to. Yes. Just like your body works together, your eyes work for you, your hands work for you, your legs work for you. God wants us as a body of people, all different, but yet the same. What's the same thing that we all have in common in here today? Let's go to the natural. What's some natural things that we have that are the same? Some of us have hair. Some of us grow it and some of us buy it. But we have it. Yes, ma'am. Yes, we have blood inside of us. Yes, ma'am. Our heart. Yeah, we all have a heart. We eat, drink, go to the toilet. That's right. So you see, we as human beings, we all have some things that are in common. And it works together when we work it. Everybody can't play the piano. Everybody can't play the drum. Everybody can't play the guitar. Everybody can't speak. Everybody can't operate technology. Everybody can't cook. No, some people don't. You shouldn't even go to the kitchen. You should decide. When you go to the kitchen, your only reason would be to wash the dishes. Clean up behind people because you cannot cook. Okay, that was an aside. I'm coming back now. It's the truth. We have different gifts. We have different talents. And if you're not in the place that you're supposed to be, the purposeful place that God has for you, and Scripture says He has a place for you, and it's to give you a future and that word, hope. And we're going to define hope as we go along here. I'm going to stop now because I think we're supposed to be doing lunch, and then we're going to come back. I hope you've gotten something out of it, but stay tuned. There's more.
Thank you. That was awesome, everyone. Don't you agree? We learned quite a lot in that short space of time. So thank you, Celinda, for that. And yes, there will be more after lunch. We're just going to take a short break. First, Sister Noreen's going to say.
Praise the Lord. I just want to take some time just to greet some people. I want to greet Pastor Nikki, who is in our midst. So let's give her a big hand clap. And also one of my colleagues from work, Jackie. Actually, she's one of the big boss. She don't like to say that, but she promised me that she'd come, and I'm so pleased. And I just thank God for the Beacon of Hope family that have come all the way. You know where they live, and they're here with us today. So we want to thank God. And I'm just saying, let us just enjoy. We have food. We're not charging for the conference, so I think the girls are charging a little bit of maybe a pound or two or so for the lunch. So enjoy. And Father, we just want to thank you to bless the food, Lord, in the name of Jesus. You said in your word that you'll bless our bread and water and take sickness from the midst of us. Lord, we hold you to your word right now. Bless the food, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.